so proficient in debate that he would first ask the opponent to say something, and when that person said something, he would contradict him. Nimai would contradict that devotee, and that devotee would not, or that scholar would not be able to defeat Mahaprabhu's statement. So Mahaprabhu would wait for some time, and when the opponent was unable to say anything, then Mahaprabhu would contradict his own statement that he had just made and established the second statement that he made. And then, in other words, he re-established the conclusion that the other man had made earlier. And the other man could not say anything. Then he refuted his second conclusion again and re-established what originally he had said himself. And this would go on several times, and it left the opponent completely bewildered. And people would wonder, what kind of intelligence does this boy have? It's not ordinary intelligence. There seems to be nothing that he doesn't know. Any subject on earth that you can think of, and he knows something, he knows everything. And he's just supposed to be a student and teacher of grammar. And grammar was supposed to be just a basic subject, and there were so many other advanced subjects after grammar. So Nimai Pandit was never defeated by anyone. This was the first time Nimai Pandit was defeated. And then it is explained that Nimai Pandit was very happy to be defeated. And Ishwar Puri then went on. So this was the first time in Navadvip they met. The second time they met was in Gaya. And this time, Ishwar Puri initiated Nimai Pandit. And after initiation, Nimai Pandit changed completely. He now became God intoxicated. He became intoxicated with love of God. He would be chanting the holy names, completely immersed and absorbed in love of God. And in fact, he was so absorbed that he started wandering towards Vrindavan, and then a voice in the sky had to tell him, look, you have a mission to do. If you go away to Vrindavan, who's going to establish the religious process for this age? So go back. So then he gathered himself and again went back to Navadvip. And then he started his congregational chanting of the holy names in the house of Srivas Thakur. Day and night they would do it. All the Vaishnavas living in Navadvip were astonished beyond measure, and they were happily astonished, because they had always thought that such a brilliant boy, this Nimai, if only he were to become a devotee, how wonderful it would be. And now their dreams were fulfilled. Nimai had become a devotee. And what a devotee he had become. Extraordinary. So when Nimai Pandit had inaugurated his mission of spreading love of God by congregational chanting of the Hare Krishna Maha Mantra, it was at this time that Haridas Thakur joined him in Navadvip. At this time, Nimai Pandit was about 23 years old. So Haridas Thakur, being about 35 years older than Nimai, would have been about 58 years old at this time. And Haridas Thakur passed away just prior to a few years before Mahaprabhu's departure. So Mahaprabhu passed away about 25 years after that. So we can see that Haridas Thakur must have been quite old when he passed away. He must have been in his late 70s, perhaps early 80s. Nityananda Prabhu was 12 years older than Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. So Haridas Thakur was 23 years older than Nityananda Prabhu. So Haridas Thakur left his village in Burhan, and some say he came to Fulia, some say he came to a village called Benapol, where many pastimes took place, and we'll talk about these pastimes a little bit today if time permits, otherwise in the classes tomorrow and day after. But before that, a brief word on why it is that Haridas Thakur, the great devotee, appeared in a Muslim family. What was the reason for this? Let's explore, first of all, the previous identity of Haridas Thakur. Now, we all know that we have a previous life, isn't it? Every one of us has a previous life. We don't know what we were in the previous life. Whatever we were somewhere. And we performed some devotional service, but we were unable to complete it. We didn't reach the point of perfection, so we had to take rebirth, and here we are. So everybody sitting in this room today has performed devotional service in the previous life. Otherwise, we wouldn't be here today. Srila Prabhupada explains in his purports in the Bhagavad Gita that no one can come to Krishna consciousness in this life without having had some connection with it in the previous life. So otherwise, why is it that someone is sitting here today in front of the deities hearing a discourse on the scriptures when he or she could well have been down at the pubs or some other place? So there is a reason. And why is it that they are not here and we are here? And the reason goes back to previous lives. So we all have a past connection with Krishna. Now all these great associates of the Lord who participate in his pastimes also have a past. There is a history of their devotional service. But because they are perfected beings, their history is not like our history. Our history is perhaps a history of a conditioned living entity struggling against the modes of nature. But for them, no. They were in Krishna Leela before. Like all the main participants of the pastimes in Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's Leela were also with Krishna in Vrindavan. And they appeared to participate in Mahaprabhu's pastimes when he appeared in Navadvip, in Puri, and so on. So similarly, Haridas Thakur. Who was Haridas Thakur? Does anyone know? Yes. Yes? He was Lord Brahma. Okay, anyone else? You raised your hand? Lord Brahma, yes? Prahlad Maharaj. Okay, any other answer? Sorry? Brahma, yes, that was said. So there are two answers so far. One is that he was Lord Brahma, and the other answer was he was Prahlad. Any other possibilities? So was he Brahma or was he Prahlad? Combination. He was both. And actually, he was a third person added, combined further. Now, there is a book called the Gaura Ganodesha Deepika. It is a book written by a saint called Kavi Karnapur, who was also an associate of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. In this book, he has given the identities, the previous identities of those great devotees who participated in Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's pastimes. So in this book, he mentions that Haridas Thakur is a combined incarnation of two personalities. Now these extraordinary things do happen, that you have combined incarnation. That means one person is actually a combination of two, three jivas, or two, three individual living entities. These things happen, especially with the associates of the Lord. It is quite a frequent occurrence. Whether it is Ramananda Rai or whether it is Haridas Thakur, these things are there. So he says that he is an incarnation of Prahlad and also Brahma. But this Brahma is not the creator Brahma. There's another Brahma. Now, Haridas Thakur is also an incarnation of the creator Brahma, but that is mentioned in another source. I'll come to that in a moment. So in the Gauda Ganudesha Deepika, it is said, he is a combined incarnation of Prahlad Maharaj and Brahma Mahatapa, who was a Brahmana, who was a son of a sage called Richika Muni. And Kavi Karnapur explains that one time, the son of Richika Muni was assisting Richika Muni in worship, and he was giving him tulasi leaves. And he gave him tulasi leaves of worship without washing them. So the father, he was very upset. And he said, I've trained you up so nicely, and you don't know the basic etiquette of how to worship the deities. You should wash the tulasi leaves. So in his anger, he cursed him to be born in a Yavana family, in a Mlecha family. Of course, behind such a curse, there is also an internal reason. The Lord has His purposes to fulfill. Shri Shri Radha Landanishwar ki jai, Shri Shri Jagannath Baladev Subhadra Devi ki jai, Shri Shri Gaur Nitai ki jai. So He has a purpose to fulfill. So anyway, He was born then in a combined incarnation with Prahlad. So we can see how subtle, how refined was Vedic culture. That's even such small infringements in those days were considered grave offenses. Nowadays, of course, we can't apply those standards, because if we do, then we won't be able to do anything. We won't be able to do any worship, because we perform so many mistakes when we perform worship. Any small thing that we do, we perform in this age, we are totally unqualified. That's why I mentioned the Vedic culture was so sophisticated and so refined that for people of this age, it's hard to think of these things. So in any case, Kavi Karnapur says that Haridas Thakur was a combined incarnation of Prahlad Maharaj and Brahma Mahatapa, the son of Richika Muni. And then in the Prema Vilas, it is mentioned that Haridas Thakur is a combined incarnation of three personalities. That's Prahlad Maharaj, Brahma Mahatapa, the son of Richika Muni, and also Brahma the creator. So generally we understand Haridas Thakur to be an incarnation of Brahma the creator. So that's not wrong, it's correct. So he's a combined incarnation of three personalities. Isn't it extraordinary? And then in the book called Navadvip Dham Mahatmya by Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur, he gives us further enlightenment. Why did Haridas Thakur appear in this situation as a Yavana in a quote-unquote low family? And he explains that the background goes to one pastime that took place in Vrindavan. Do you know that pastime? Which pastime? Yes? Yes, when Lord Brahma kidnapped all the calves, and the cowherd boys. Yes, this is the pastime which is relevant to understand the identity of Haridas Thakur. When Krishna was about 5 years old, he had taken, as usual, the cows out for grazing along with his cowherd boy friends. And when they were sitting down, the friends, and chatting together, somehow they noticed that some of the cows had grazed away, wandered away. So the friends were concerned about the cows, where are the cows, and so on. So Krishna said, "Don't worry, my dear friends, you stay here. I will go and check it. I will go and check where the calves are. I will take care of the situation." So he left. Now in the meanwhile, because Krishna had been eating with his cowherd boyfriends ordinary food, that common people eat. Brahma was a little perplexed. You see, there's a difference between the food ordinary people eat and sophisticated people eat, isn't it? The sophisticated people who live in big houses, they will have so much nice cutlery and nice kitchen and nice dining hall with so much of refined, finely cooked foods and things. And maybe those who are not so wealthy will eat a little roughly. They eat. And then what to speak of God? Generally, when we think of God, we think of someone who's almighty, all powerful, all opulent, which indeed he is. And we think that therefore he should also eat like such a big man, grand food. And here was Krishna on the bank of the Yamuna, sitting with his friends, eating with both hands, which is uncultured anyway. According to Vedic culture, you're not supposed to eat with the left hand, only supposed to eat with the right hand. But he had food in both hands, and he was eating with both hands. And then one food in one hand there was some fruit with yogurt, in other hand there was some similar food. And the boys were exchanging jokes with each other, eating from each other's hands, stealing each other's boxes of lunch. And Brahma was there watching from the sky, and he was in a swan carrier. Brahma is not an ordinary person, so he can see. When we go up in an airplane and we look down, even the big skyscrapers look like matchboxes. Srila Prabhupada said that. So just imagine, when you're up in a plane, even these huge skyscrapers appear so tiny. Then imagine what everything looks like from Krishna's point of view. And he's so high. There's millions and millions of universes that he sees. So what are these universes for him? Insignificant. So Brahma was there on his swan carrier watching the whole situation, and he was really surprised. How could he be the Supreme Lord? Just eating such ordinary food? He should be having some grand, you know, banquet or something like that. How can God behave in such an ordinary way, just sitting on the floor, not even on a proper throne or something, and sitting with boys and everyone stealing food from him, and he's stealing food from somebody, and playing jokes with each other? This can't be God. But Brahma knew he was God. So he said, okay, let me test him so I can see his opulences and his glories. So when Krishna looked for the cows and calves who Brahma had actually hidden, then Brahma came down, and he's very powerful. He has so much mystic power. So he, by the power of his mystic ability, he made all the cowherd boys go to sleep. He made the calves go to sleep and transferred them to a cave. So when Krishna came back, here and there looking around, he had food in both his hands and looking, where are my cows? Where are my friends? I went looking for my cows. The cows are not there. And I come back and find even my friends are not there. What's going on here? And then he understood, yes, this is the work of Brahma. Because Krishna is in the heart of every living entity, including Brahma. So he said, okay, Brahma wants, he's my devotee, but he's got a little bewildered. So let me exhibit a very, very tiny, tiny portion of my mystic powers. And then Krishna expanded himself into all the cowherd boys and all the calves who had been stolen by Brahma. And these replicas were so identical, not only in appearance, but even in the way they spoke, the way they behaved. Everything was just perfect. Even their parents, the mothers, couldn't make out that it wasn't their child. There was only one thing that got the parents bewildered. What was that? Does anyone know? in this pastime? What was the one thing that bewildered the mothers of these cowherd boys? Yes. Yes. They were wondering, why is it that we love our son more than we love Krishna? You see, the speciality of Vrindavan is that everyone loved Krishna more than anyone or anything else in this world. Generally, people love their own children very much. They may love other children also, but they love their own children more. It's natural. But in Vrindavan, Krishna was so all-attractive that all the residents of Vrindavan, the Vrajabasis, they loved Krishna more than they loved their own children. And now that Krishna had expanded himself to become their sons, which they didn't know, they found their affection for their sons to be equal to the affection they had for Krishna. They did not know that whom they loved as their sons for this period of time was actually Krishna. So in any case, this went on for one full year. Krishna continued with his pastimes as if nothing had happened. When Brahma came back after one moment of his time, which was 1 year of time on earth, he was bewildered to see everything going on normally as before. And he was thinking, how has this happened? Have they escaped somehow from the cave? So he went back to the cave and saw that the calves and the cowherd boys were very much fast asleep under the power of his mystic potency. Then he came back to where Krishna was and saw that the cows and the cowherd boys were there. So Brahma was really bewildered. How could these calves and cowherd boys be in two places at the same time? How is this possible? Brahma stood there stunned and speechless. Brahma realized that he had become a little proud of his own mystic powers, little realizing that his mystic powers were nothing in comparison to Krishna's mystic powers. In fact, Brahma realized that if Krishna was like the sun in the daytime, then he was like the firefly. You know what a firefly is? It's an insect that comes at night sometime. It glows. It's a glowworm. And when it glows at night, it looks very beautiful. Because everything else around is dark. So when there's an insect that glows brightly, it's quite fascinating, attractive. But when the sun rises and the sunshine spreads everywhere, then what is the value of that glowworm or that firefly? Who can see even such a firefly? Even if the firefly were to glow with all its power, it wouldn't even be noticed in the bright sunshine of the day. So long as Krishna's mystic power was not exhibited, Brahma thought his own powers to be very significant. But now that Krishna had exhibited just a very atomic fraction of his powers, and those powers bewildered Brahma, Brahma could now not understand how powerful Krishna was. And then he began to feel really embarrassed and even afraid. My God, literally, my God, yes. Krishna is God. So, my God, what have I done? I have committed a big offense. So now I must somehow make up for it. I must come in front of Krishna and I must apologize to him. So he did that. And Krishna, remember, in Vrindavan, is just a cowherd boy. In Vrindavan, Krishna doesn't play God. In fact, human beings like to play God, but God doesn't like to play God. God likes to play like a human, and the humans like to play God. That's the unfortunate irony of our times and the material world. So, Krishna was still continuing his pastime, as if You know, he had just returned from searching for the cows. And he saw the four-headed Brahma, golden complexion, shining brightly. Brahma is a very attractive personality. After all, he is the creator of the universe. He has four heads. And he came there, stood with folded hands, and bent all his four heads in supplication and submission to Krishna. And then Krishna wanted to teach Haridas Thakur, Brahma, a lesson. You see, one of the ways to indicate your disapproval is to rebuke someone, or get angry with someone, or fight with someone, isn't it? If someone does something you don't like to you, then you will speak something sometimes. Another way of expressing disapproval is to ignore that person, isn't it? Does it happen sometimes? So Krishna decided on the second route. When Brahma was standing there with folded hands, the creator of the universe, Krishna pretended to ignore him. He just didn't even look at him. He had food in both his hands, little hands, and he was looking bewildered, looking around, where are my cows, where are my cowherd boyfriends, and he was looking around like that. And then Brahma came in his way and he looked, who is this big man with four heads and a golden complexion? I don't know who is this person. I'm just a cowherd boy living here in Vrindavan. And Brahma, after repeated attempts to come forward and offer prayers, which he did, in fact, do, when Krishna didn't give much attention to him and he dispatched him finally, then Brahma was even more fearful. Actually, Brahma now became so appreciative of the devotees of Vrindavan that he prayed to Krishna, let me take birth as some grass in Vrindavan. So great are the devotees of Vrindavan that the Supreme Lord plays with them just like they are his friends. Because Brahma had witnessed these pastimes with Krishna and his cowherd boyfriends, how intimate the dealings were. So Brahma had been really impressed with that. So he said, let me become a clump of grass in Vrindavan. This is also what Uddhava had prayed, right? You have heard that example about Uddhava, the great devotee. He also prayed like that when he understood the glories of the love of the residents of Vrindavan for Krishna. So Brahma prayed. Chapter 14 of the 10th canto has beautiful prayers expressed by Brahma. But Krishna wasn't really paying much attention, externally at least. He was looking here and there, where is Sudama, where is Subal, where is Ujjvala, where have they all gone? And here was Brahma saying, you know, so many wonderful things in glorification of Krishna. And then when Brahma didn't get the proper response and he was given such an ignore by Krishna, he was thinking, I better not further interfere in the pastimes of the Lord. The Lord has come here as a cowherd boy. He is in the mood of a cowherd boy. He is not in the mood of God, so I should not interfere now, because I am spoiling the whole mood. Just like if there is someone who's acting as a king and his friend from the real world comes and slaps him on his back and says, you know, how are you doing? Spoils the mood, isn't it? He's a friend, all right, but that's outside. But this drama, this man is the king and you got to deal with him like a king. If you deal with him differently, then you spoil the whole mood of the drama. So similarly, Krishna's eternal drama is going on in Vrindavan. Krishna is God, but in Vrindavan he likes to play the continuous eternal drama of being a cowherd boy. This is his pastime. So Brahma came to the realization that I should not spoil this drama, this transcendental drama that's going on. I better leave from here now. I've already been very offensive. And now after trying to beg forgiveness, Krishna is giving me the royal ignore. So he's giving me a message that I should better leave from here. So he went back. But Brahma was still in anxiety, still in fear. Just like, you know, when we speak harshly to somebody, we come back and we repent. Oh, I shouldn't have spoken like that. Does it happen sometimes? I think all of us have experienced it. We react harshly to somebody and then we repent after some time. And then we wonder, oh, I really shouldn't have done that. So Brahma was thinking, what do I do now? And then Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur explains in the Navadvip Dham Mahatmya that he came down to Antardvip, one of the 9 dvipas or islands of Navadvip. The meaning of the word Navadvip is 9 islands. Nava means 9, dvip means islands. So Navadvip is composed of 9 islands. So the central island is Antardvip. So Bhaktivinoda Thakur says, then Brahma came there to perform a meditative penance and to understand what he could do to somehow atone for his big offense to Krishna. So he came there. Soon after that episode, at that time the Lord appeared before him and said, my dear Brahma, don't worry, you will appear in a Yavana family very soon, in a few thousand years, when I will also appear in the guise of a Brahmana, and I will appear to inaugurate the religious process for this age, the Sankirtana movement, and then you will participate in that. You will have a very important role to play. So Brahma was very pacified to hear. And Brahma actually preferred to have a low birth. Why so? Because he thought, I have such a high birth as Brahma. You know, who is Brahma? Not just the secondary creator, but he is the first Brahmana, the first Guru, the most cultured person in the universe, the most pious person in the universe. That's how he gets the post of Brahma. The most knowledgeable person, the senior most devotee in the universe, first initiated. He was initiated directly by Krishna. Krishna directly was his initiating and instructing Guru. Diksha and Shiksha both directly from Krishna. He compiled the Vedas. I mean, the kinds of qualifications, if Brahma were to write his biodata or his curriculum vitae, CV, it would really be impressive. Such a high birth and such qualification. But one of the things that happens when there are such high qualifications is that one becomes proud. So Brahma was thinking, oh, I became proud because of my high position, my high birth, my high learning, and all the other qualifications that I have. And because of this pride, I committed this offense against the Supreme Lord. I do not know when I will be able to atone for this. Now the Lord has given me a chance to appear as his associate when he will come as Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. But this time I will not take a chance. This time I will not appear in a high family, in a high position, in a high birth. I will appear in an ordinary family. In fact, not just ordinary, but in a low class family. What is considered socially an outcast in the Vedic culture. In a family of Yavanas. Then where is the question of any pride? Then in that situation of I will be naturally humble and then I can serve the Lord very nicely, participate in his pastimes and also atone for all the offenses that I have done against the Supreme Lord. So then Brahma therefore took birth in a Yavana or a Muslim family. This was one reason, and Bhaktivinoda Thakur has explained this. Another reason, of course, for understanding how Haridas Thakur appeared in a family of this sort is that Chaitanya Mahaprabhu had come to establish the Yuga Dharma, the religious process for this age, and he wanted to demonstrate that the process of love of God, Krishna consciousness, is not dependent on any caste, on any community, creed, nationality, gender, education, wealth, social status, and so on. Anyone, whether his or her birth is high or low, they can all become pure devotees of the Lord and attain perfection in spiritual life. So, many of Haridas Thakur's, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's associates took birth in such situations. For example, Rupa Goswami and Sanatan Goswami were also considered by the orthodox people of his time as outcasts because they were serving the Yavanas. And there were others also like that. So this is very instructive. In the Chaitanya Bhagavat, Vrindavan Das Thakur mentions that it often happens in the pastimes of the Lord that his associates are born in circumstances that are, in terms of Vedic culture, considered low. For example, Hanuman appeared in a family of monkeys, animals. That's considered low, even not human beings. Jatayu, who tried valiantly to save Sita as she was being kidnapped by Ravana, and who died, actually sacrificed his life to try to save Sita Devi, was a vulture, a bird. There were so many other devotees of the Lord in different circumstances. Jambavan, the bear, is an animal. And they all participated in the Lord's pastimes as his associates. They became his main soldiers in the battle against Ravana. So similarly, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu also wanted to send a message to the world. And the message is that to be my devotee, it doesn't matter who you are. It doesn't matter what country you belong to, what religion you belong to, what caste, creed, or community you belong to. It doesn't matter whether you are rich or poor, male or female. It doesn't matter. We are all, at the end of the day, spirit souls. As souls, we are all part and parcel of Lord Krishna. And we have an eternal relationship of love with Krishna. And Krishna consciousness is the process of reawakening that natural love for Krishna. All these distinctions that we have of caste and creed and community and so on and so forth are based upon the body. But this body is perishable. In our previous lives, we had some other identity of some community, creed, etc. In this life, we have one identity. In the next life, we will have yet another identity. So our physical bodily identities change even in this life. But our spiritual identity never changes. So we, from a worldly point of view, may make a distinction. Oh, this one is such and such of this community, that one is of that community. But from a spiritual point of view, there is no difference. So Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu wanted to say that everyone has access to this privilege of becoming a lover of God, of becoming a devotee of Krishna. It is a birthright of every living being to perfect his or her life by becoming true and pure lovers of God. So therefore he wanted some of his devotees to be born in what was considered low-class families in those days. And he chose some of his chief associates to be born in such families. and he used them as vehicles for propagating his movement of chanting the holy names and spreading love of God everywhere. So Haridas Thakur's birth in this situation in a Yavana family has to be seen with this context. He was born like this by the Lord's arrangement. The society at that time was very, very orthodox. And therefore, they didn't consider people from such backgrounds taking to Krishna consciousness very nicely. So Mahaprabhu had a very deep reason there. We'll talk more about it tomorrow evening. Tomorrow morning, His Holiness Chandramouli Swami Maharaj will give the Bhagavatam class. So please do come and take benefit of his saintly association and hear his wonderful message. That's tomorrow morning. And then tomorrow evening we will continue the glorification of Haridas Thakur. We haven't even begun talking about his pastimes yet. We're just talking of giving a background of who he is and why he was what he was. So that every time we hear Haridas Thakur's pastimes, we will appreciate better. So now we will have the Sandhya Arati. Thank you very much. Srila Prabhupada ki jai. Shri Shri Radha Landanishwar ki jai. Shri Shri Jagannath Baladev Subhadra Devi ki jai. Gaur Premanande.